Hi, Minster here. Welcome to my Merciless Ice Crash Leveling Guide. This is part of a series. You can find the playlist in my channel. In the description, you'll find a link to the forum post. Thoughts and questions are welcome there. For Merciless, I will not go into depth about boss fights, etc., etc., but focus on gear. It's important to know what your end goal is, so you can plan for it and acquire the pieces most efficiently. This build is blessed by divination cards that yield 6 linked gear. And that's a big relief, since you will be able to forgo the aggravating horror of trying to make a 6 link yourself. Up first is a 6 linked Arster Plate. An Arster Plate is an excellent base since it gives some resistances. Be warned, high item level is needed for crafting the best gear, and the maximum is your aim, and that is level 80. Turning a set of cards in as a level 60 character will yield an item level 60 Arster Plate. Many players have shed tears over their mistake, so be warned. Turn to a trusted friend if you want your Arster Plate before character level 80. Here's an example of turning in an irrelevant item that will be maximum level 80. Up next is the 6 linked Coronal Maul. It's an excellent base, gives extra AoE. The item level is always 83, and 83 is needed for the best possible weapon rolls for a physical melee character. And this disregards your own character level, so it will always be 83. The catch, however, is its possible drop place. It drops in Arsenal, a high tier map. So in a new league, focus your energy on getting an Arsenal plate first, since it'll take quite some time before you reach Arsenal or people selling the divination card. It will take some time. One 6 link can be all you need for a very long time anyway, so focus on the Arster Plate. Rolling an item level 83 weapon takes a lot of currency. Even though it's already linked, you're not quite there yet. There are multiple routes to take, either Alteration Orb and Regal high percentage physical damage, or just Chaos Spam. Do not expect to get decent results with less than 3 exalted worth of currency. There are no guarantees, and this project can be a real money pit. Now we know possible endgame items you can farm yourself. One self-sufficient way of going about it would be, instead of getting ready for mapping in Docks and Dried Lake, you could choose to farm in Act 2 Crypt Level 2. Once you get your gear and your level sorted, continue farming the card in the map called the Crypt. My experience with the drop rate is, one card drops every 10 to 15 maps that are rolled as rares, so yes, good RNG is needed to acquire these cards quickly. In Merciless, you'll be looking for a good weapon. A popular unique is the unique maul called Maroi Eraki. A lot of players has asked me in the past if this would be the preferred weapon, and that's why I'll take my time in this video going over the pros and cons of this weapon. Past leagues, it's been relatively cheap compared to faster rare mauls. In the land of the blind, one eye is king, so if you're poor, this will always be an excellent choice. The damage of a single hit is huge, and a lot more than the rare two-handed maces. The higher the damage in a single hit, the more chance you will have to stun monsters. So white monsters and even champions will be one shot, but rares and uniques, this will be a big deal. It has a gem modifier built in, a level 15 increased area of effect, and that fits Ice Crash perfectly. Now it's time to test run this weapon and compare it to a faster rare. So a 5 link Maroi, effectively 6 link with the built-in gem, versus a 5 linked rare. While this comparing goes on, I'll talk about other pieces of gear. For example, I've dropped Blasphemy Warlords in favor of Herald of Ash. Since I do not want to curse manually with my crappy cast speed, I want to keep pace by using Asenath Gloves. These gloves will make my attacks apply the cursed temporal chains, a perfect curse to lock down monsters. My boots are the nerfed version of Blood Dance. These are a source for frenzy charges. Those boots do not have life and resistances, so I'll be dropping them before mapping so I can overcap my resistances with a rare pair of boots. Overcapping resistances, that term means getting more resistances than 75, your maximum, and the benefits are huge. If you get cursed by a monster, your resistances will always stay at the max. This will also keep your resistance on the maximum in an elemental weakness map. For endgame mapping, this is a must-have in my eyes. I've even had a character with double overcap, because I was chaining maps with elemental weakness curse so much, it was totally worth it. So back to the boots. The other source for frenzy charges would be Blood Rage. This also comes at a price. You'll be degenerating life, as physical damage. This damage cannot be mitigated by armor, however, fortify, endurance charges, and other percentage based physical mitigation does work. The price is real. Having a lot of life regeneration gives you more time to react to danger. Blood Rage can also become dangerous in combination with map mods. Vulnerability Curse and Shock Ground will make you take more damage, and penalties to life regeneration will reduce your ability to compensate for the degen effect. Many players simply turn off their Blood Rage for the occasional map just to be safe. Another vital part of this build is having a quality hypothermia gem. This is overlooked a lot. The gem quality increases the chill duration, and since chill duration has a threshold duration, as in if you chill for a fraction of a second below the threshold, the target will not be chilled at all. So if that 20% quality gem suddenly makes the duration to chill above that threshold, you're suddenly chilling everything that moves. This is especially vital for chilling bosses, besides the ability to chill them with a flask that gives chilled ground. All gems have great quality bonuses, however, hypothermia is hardly used at all, and hence very, very cheap, and thus good to look out for to buy from other players at this stage of your progress through the game. Other cheap quality gems are Ice Crash, Heavy Strike, Stun, and Endurance Charge on melee stun. Quality gems like faster attacks and weapon elemental damage are among the most expensive gems. Stun builds are relatively cheap too. A studded belt with reduced enemy stun threshold and life will look really ugly to almost all the other builds. Most good stun builds will be corrupted, since the player wanted to get rid of the stun duration and swap it for maximum charge. Good for this build, the corrupt usually fails, and the stun stays intact, leaving the player no option but to sell the belt for bottom price. And we'll be picking it up, thank you. Okay, back to our Marowi versus Rare contest. The damage of the Marowi is impressive. The difference would have been less big if I've used an hypothermia gem in the rare maze, but still, the raw power of the Marowi would win by a landslide. So why are we having this debate then? Well, this build revolves around locking down monsters. And a very big hitting first. The motto is first strike, first stun, first kill. I'd rather hit first, stun first, and then finish off my helpless targets with two hits, then one shot the stuff. Like a Marowi scenario where your character gets hit hard, next you hit back even harder and kill everything that have dared to move close to you. End game, nightmares walk around, and when the stars align, they will be able to one shot you. But being able to hit those monsters first, your survivability increases to acceptable levels. Therefore, to use the Marowi for Ice Crash, you have to be able to acquire tons and tons of attack speed. Leap slamming with the attack penalty instead of the bonus of a rare will nerf your clear speed by a lot. It might even be better to move around by foot than by leap slamming. All completely a different playstyle. So, to conclude, if Marowi is your only option, go for it. Excellent weapon. Super choice for leveling up and getting ready for endgame. Preferred choice, however, is a fast rare for the first strike motto. And an extra note, if you're willing to pay the price, namely if you give up the ability to level up spare gems in the open weapon slot, you can use the Marowi in combination with the rare maze in the weapon swap position. You'll set up the Marowi for a heavy strike to kill bosses, and that works like a charm. You can pay to win and microtransaction weapon effect on the weapon, so you can distinguish visually what weapon you're currently holding. Right, that was it for Merciless. I hope this cleared up the question to Marowi or not to Marowi. Up next is a video about mapping and transforming into your endgame build.